Thank you all for being here. As Ted said, my name is Kelly. I teach statistics and data science. And on this first slide, you are seeing the beautiful city of Barcelona, Spain. And I put that up there because a week from today, I will hopefully be there to meet my boyfriend's parents for the first time. He is fully Spanish. I very wisely took 10 years of French, so I don't really speak Spanish. And I have been practicing a bit. And so that has gotten me thinking a little about translating between, you know, ordinary languages and translating between programming languages. And so this whole hook was, of course, just an excuse for me to be like, hey, everyone, I have a boyfriend. That's him. and so, you know, I've been listening to this podcast that teaches Spanish, and there was this phrase that they were teaching that kind of struck me. And it looked like this: me gusta ver a mis amigos. Sorry for the pronunciation. And that ah, the ver a mis amigos, was the point of the episode. It's kind of a weird construction for what they're trying to say is, I like to see my friends. But of course, if you were to translate, you know, word for word or literally to English, we would be saying, it is pleasing to me to see to my friends, which of course is not a thing that we say in English. And so this got me thinking about that, like, idea of a one-to-one direct translation and how that's not really how languages actually work. So can we apply this sort of theory of language learning to programming languages instead? So I'd like to start off with a pop quiz. It's the first talk of this year's conf besides the keynote, and I'm hitting you with a quiz. Sorry, not sorry. Here's your pop quiz. Oops, I don't know why that's not showing. Okay, you get my pop quiz in words. This code right here. Is the object returned by that code going to be two-dimensional, like a matrix or a data frame or something with rows and columns? Or is it going to be one-dimensional, like a vector or an array? Who's going to say one-dimensional? Who's going to say two-dimensional? Kudos to you people who raised your hands for two-dimensional after seeing the one-dimensional. The answer, as you might expect, is it's a trick question. As we know, POSIT is no longer an R-only company. In R, this exact code right here, taking a column of the penguins data set, is going to be one-dimensional, right? That's yanking out a column. In Python, that thing's two-dimensional. That is a data frame with one column. So this is an example of there is not a direct translation between these two rather similar, rather close languages. That exact code will run in both languages, and it will produce a different structure of results. So what motivated this? There's a class that I teach every year at Cal Poly. It's called statistical learning. And we're kind of upgrading it to statistical learning with R, but then I've added in the Python. So this class is kind of an upper level class. It's mostly, but not entirely, stat majors in their final years of their undergrad degree. There's no computing prerequisite. I think we're gonna change that. I'm turning this off because I'm getting echo. There we go. There's no computing prerequisite, so any R or Python that I use, I have to kind of spoon feed a little bit. Back when this class was first offered, 2020, I didn't teach it. It used kind of a hodgepodge, as many of us have done with modeling, right? It was using, you know, Caret and BaseR and tidyverse for the data wrangling and just kind of all over the place. So when I took it over, I changed it to tidymodels. And that was really fun. Like, tidymodels was kind of new, and it made it so much easier to teach it. I could go on, but that's not the point of this talk. And then this year, for some reason, instead of doing the smart thing and just reusing my materials with little tweaks that had gone very well, I decided to translate everything also into scikit-learn in Python. So I want to tell you what this talk isn't. I am not encouraging you to do this. This was extra work for me without a huge amount of benefit in the class. I am not trying to encourage you to teach a bilingual class, although if you're interested, I would love to talk to you about it. I did it kind of because there's sort of these two funnels into this course, and one side of that funnel is the computer science, data science minors. I wanted it to be accessible. I want it to fit in our eventual data science bachelor's program. And I really wanted to practice, and you know, it's one of those things where like you commit when you're feeling enthusiastic and then you're forced into it, right? So I wanted to practice Python, I wanted to pick up Quarto, which is nice for using both. So that's why I did it. So I'm not telling you to do it, I did it for fun. So that's not the point of this talk. So what is the point of this talk? What I want to talk to you about is what I learned from watching the students learn differently from these two languages, like the two cohorts who chose R versus Python. And specifically thinking about how these different implementations, not just across languages, but maybe even across packages, is going to impact understanding for these users. And specifically, I know most people in this room, maybe because of the track, might be educators, but I kind of have split this out into advice for developers or creators, for users of the tools, and then, of course, most importantly, for educators. Oops, one step behind, there we go. So let's dive in. So thinking about like how you learn a new language or how you translate between languages, and now I'm thinking back to like Spanish and French. Probably the first thing that comes to mind that's hard that was in my first example is grammar, and specifically like sentence structure. Like why do these same words go in a totally different order in different languages? And so how I might kind of parallel that in programming languages is this idea of what's the structure of your analysis. Like you have to do these multiple steps to do an analysis, but in different implementations, those steps might happen at different times. So here's what I mean. Here's two code chunks. The top one is scikit-learn, is Python. The bottom one down there is tidymodels, is you know, R, of course. And my question to you is when in these two chunks do we decide which predictors are going to go into our model? It's just a linear model with a couple of predictors. And that's happening right here. So it feels kind of the same in both languages right now, right? At the moment where you are fitting the data after you've specified your model, that's when you're declaring which variables are part of this model. But then you start thinking about pre-processing. So here's some Python code that includes a step where we are log transforming both of our quantitative predictors. And so we've added some stuff to the process, but you can see, you know, in Python, the pre-processing decision happens early, and then the decision about which predictors we're actually doing that to happens at the fit step. But in tidy models here, right, we now have this idea of recipes. Did this just go off? There we go. This idea of recipes, right? So the recipe then contains both the decision about your predictors and the decision about how you are going to transform them. And even though it's all together, it's actually in the opposite order. You choose your predictors and then your transformations. And so this is slightly different. And I'm not saying it's wrong. Like, I don't think that either one is necessarily wrong. But having different approaches is going to have consequences. And so here's what happened with my students. Like, the ones that were using tidy models kind of focused really on feature selection. They really focused on like which predictors are going to be in my model. And then once they decided that, they were like, and maybe we could log transform them. And the ones who use scikit-learn really focused on like how do we adjust the data. They kind of thought of this transformation as part of the data cleaning. And they did that first and then allowed some predictors or others to be in their model. So what's the takeaway from that observation? Well, developers, I just want you to be aware of how like your API design is going to influence how people think about the actual concepts, right? This is not like a separate thing. And then I want, when possible, if you can be kind of agnostic, if you can allow, like I'm thinking of how, you know, the recipes and the model specification and tidy models, it doesn't really matter which order you declare them. They're sort of separate entities that you put together later. I think that's a really good design choice, personally. And then my last suggestion is just keeping kind of related decisions together. Like, I don't necessarily think scikit-learn is wrong, but I don't like this thing that you go through the whole setup and then you specify your predictors. And of course, you could like insert steps where you make another data frame to kind of solve for that, but the way that it's sort of naturally set up doesn't keep those decisions together. My advice for users here, try to match your code flow with your narrative where you have choices. You know, if you are thinking through a problem in a certain way, try to match your code. And then, of course, like intersperse your code with text. This is why that discussion and documentation is so important. If you're doing two parallel analyses in different languages, but you have to kind of shuffle parts of it, then you are going to need that discussion text to help match those up. There you go. And then as much as you can kind of compartmentalize, make your steps modular, here's where we choose the model, here's where we choose the predictors, that also kind of lets you swap between languages. And then my advice for educators here, you know, enforce a workflow on your students that matches the way that you teach it. Break your analyses up, same idea as the practitioners. If you are isolating these decisions, then when they see them in different orders, they recognize that decision. And then, you know, really push students to document, to write what they're doing, to state their decisions outside the context of the code. All right, next thing that I find difficult in learning languages is false friends, or faux amis, when I learned French, words that sound really similar and have different meanings. So if I come up to you later in this conference and I say this, you're probably gonna make that face if you are not a Spanish speaker. But it turns out I have learned that this just means I have a cold, I'm kind of congested. It doesn't mean what you might think. Or another one, you know, if you come up to me and you say your talk was quite good, I'm gonna be really happy, unless I find out that you are from the UK, where quite means like meh, you know. So this word quite in English does not mean the same thing in every culture. And so what does this look like in code? What it looks like to me, you know, is similar functions or arguments that behave differently. So by way of example, I want to talk a little about support vector machines. Not going to teach you support vector machines. I'm going to do this really quick. We are trying to find a line to separate these two classes. We want that line to sort of push the classes apart as much as possible. So we want those dotted lines to be as far from the solid line. But as we push the classes apart, we end up with, on the right-hand side, those points that are misclassified or that kind of fall inside that margin. So when we fit a support vector machine, we're trying to like minimize that misclassification, maximize that margin. This is the push and pull. And so as you would hope, you know, in the implementation in tidy models, there is indeed a parameter that is the cost of having points fall inside of a margin. And in scikit-learn, as you would hope, there is a parameter C that has to do with the cost of points falling in the margin. But let's look at those a little more closely. Tidymodels version is the cost of predicting wrong. So the cost of a sample landing in the margin or like on the wrong side. In scikit-learn, notice that it says C, the strength of the regularization is inversely proportional to C. The regularization being that penalization for misclassification. So these work opposite. They're capturing the same thing, they're capturing the same idea. Again, neither is wrong. But when my students sitting next to each other using different languages tried the same values for cost and for C, because they were trying to tune their model, they got different results. And that was very confusing to them and to me for quite some time. And so what happens here is that then those students, of course, like conceptualize that penalty differently. So the tidymodel students are conceptualizing it as a penalty on misclassification, whereas the scikit-learn students are conceptualizing it as like a balancing parameter, you know, a regularization parameter. How much do we balance the margin, the desire for a wide margin with the desire for less points inside that margin? So it's you know, again, not wrong, leads to different ideas, and so what I would remind everyone to do is, you know, be explicit if you're designing tools. I think cost of misclassification helped me track down what was going on. I think amount of regularization did not, because regularization is a little more general. And then, you know, I'm not asking for consistency in parameterization. I'm not asking that you make sure everything's the same. I'm asking that you be upfront because it's not possible that everything's the same, and people like me need to be able to track down what the difference is. My advice for educators and practitioners, state everything in words. Say things like, when the cost is higher, we expect less misclassification, and the cost of that is a smaller margin. Like, if you say that out loud, then you are understanding that parameter. And then, as always, you know, translate these choices to non-code language. Term three, moving swiftly along. I think that learning languages' slang terms become hard. My favorite slang term in English is stand. You know this phrase stand, to stand something or to be a stan? It means you like are a big fan, basically. We're all stans of R in here. How many of you know where it came from? So this came from a music video and song by Eminem about like a very obsessed fan whose name was literally Stan, like Stanley. And somehow over the years this word evolved to mean something much broader and something that is used, you know, and people don't even remember that it came from a person's name. And so I think the equivalent of slang in code is maybe these like helper wrapper functions that contain a whole lot of meaning, like way more than what that one word might suggest. And where I see this in my class is in tuning parameters. So when you tune, and we're sticking here with those support vector machines, when you tune, you need to decide which values you're gonna try, right? And in both Python on top and R on the bottom, you can just sort of manually create, you know, kind of that list of different values that we're going to try for our model. But tidymodels also comes with this shortcut where we can like access built-in functions with the names of the parameters, and it will automatically choose values for you that it thinks are reasonable. And like, I love this. I'm not saying this is bad. Like, I would much rather have Max Kuhn decide which values I'm tuning than me decide. That's great, right? I don't know why like 0.0009 and 32 are better choices than 10, 20, 30, but I assume Max does, or whoever wrote this part of tidymodels. I'm fine with it. But again, this was my biggest shock in the class. The Python students picked it up better. Like, everyone understood tuning the first time that I taught it, and then 9 weeks of hands-on activities later, if you asked the R students about tuning, they went into detail on the functions. And if you asked the Python students, they got the concept. We just try a bunch of different values and see what sticks. And so that was surprising to me. And so I don't really have advice. Like, these shortcut functions are great. I don't think they should change. I'm not saying that. I do think, like, again, that translating to English is a good thing. But most importantly for educators, not clicking for me, there we go. The educators, you know, think about if you're using a wrapper function, basically assume that what you're doing is glossing over that concept. So that's okay, like I do this with step PCA. I don't teach all of PCA necessarily when I'm pre-processing, but avoid shortcut functions on things that are actually like learning goals in your class. Okay, I got 2 minutes. I think this next one I will do quickly. So. The last challenge I want to point out is like meaning that isn't in words, that's in gestures. And in the movie Encanto, we have, oh, it's not moving, this moment where she points with her lips, and I've learned that this is like a super cool cultural thing in Colombia that we don't do in the US, is pointing with your lips. So here's your pop quiz in the code context, and I won't make you vote because I'm low on time. Why is the question not showing up? There we go. How does the k-means function choose initial clusters? If you don't know k-means, ignore it. I asked this on Twitter. This is what people said. This is what I would have said before I dug into this. And it is not correct. So here's how I used to teach k-means. Choose your initial centroids by choosing 3 random observations. Assign all the points to the nearest centroid. Recompute the centroids of each cluster. Keep going until you have clusters. I've taught it that way for years. It turns out that nothing about that is correct about how k-means actually works. I mean, it can be, you can set it to be, but that is not the default in this function. The default in this function, although it says that it will choose 3 initial observations, down there, that method, Hartigan-Wong default method, Hartigan-Wong neither initializes that way, nor does it even update in the same way as the other methods. So everything I've just told you is not the default. In scikit-learn, they're a little more upfront, but now this initialization, K++, that's different. At least they kind of explain it, but they just say it's smart. And then you could think about using different functions in R. That one contains K++. K++ is not an option to the base k-means function. But now we don't have an option to choose your iteration process. So there is literally no way to guarantee, at least with these two implementations, that the R and the Python output matches. And so what was the result? Just frustration, just you cannot make that output be the same with the implementations people use. And so I think these get repeated. I'm gonna skip to kind of my final takeaways because they contain those ones. So, recap. We have these challenges, and these challenges that you see in language also appear in coding. So the developers in the room, what I want you to do, don't assume that the choice of the parameter name tells people what that parameter does. Don't assume that these default choices are the obvious choices. They're not universal. You have to document them. And the order that we code is the order that we think. For practitioners, again, translation is not going to be a direct word for word. Please discuss what you're deciding. Please document. Please use text. And for educators, really what you want to do is force your students to be explicit about every decision. So thank you for sticking with me. The slides are, whoopsies, online. Oh, there we go. Please find me. Please talk to me. I'm going to have to jet to the other talk. But